There are a lot of different types of descriptive studies that are used in psychology. In this video, I'm going to talk about some of the most commonly used ones. Those are case studies, naturalistic observations, surveys, and archival research. The important thing to keep in mind about all these types of studies is that they are designed to describe things, not to show connections or prove any type of cause and effect relationship. Let's start by talking about case studies, or sometimes you hear them referred to as being clinical studies. Regardless of what you call them, this type of study involves doing a detailed description of someone, or sometimes a small group of people. Typically, the subject or the subjects of a case study are usually someone that is very unique. This may mean that they experience something really extraordinary, or that they have some really unique characteristic, or maybe even a really rare disorder. Let me give you some examples. In the middle part of the 1800s, a railway worker named Phineas Gage was involved in an accident. An explosion went off near where he was working and caused a piece of metal to pierce his skull. The amazing thing here is that Phineas survived this accident. So just think about that for a second. This is the 1800s. There's no helicopter to take you to the hospital. There's no MRIs or advanced surgical practices to help you out if something like this happens. So despite all that, he survived. Because what Phineas experienced was so unique and amazing, he was the subject of many case studies describing what happened to him and how it affected him. Another example is a man named Clive Waring. Clive experienced a viral infection in the 1980s that damaged a part of his brain called the hippocampus. Now, the hippocampus is important for making new memories. So when it was damaged by the infection, it damaged Clive's ability to form new memories. Clive is still alive today. He's in his 80s. He has lived for more than 40 years without the ability to form new memories. Just hearing that, I know I have a ton of things I want to know about how a man can live for 40 years without the ability to form new memories. So that would definitely be a good topic for a case study. Moving on, we come to naturalistic observations. When I think of naturalistic observations, I think of a nature documentary. You know, like the ones where you watch the animals in the wild and it talks about how they hunt and mate and raise their young and just how they live their lives. This is kind of like a naturalistic observation. With naturalistic observations, researchers observe people in their natural setting. So for example, if you want to see how kids interact with other kids, you could go to a school and just sit and watch and make notes on what you observe. There are two main issues with this though. The first is that sometimes you can't observe people in their natural setting. Say if I wanted to do a naturalistic observation of how people drive a car. I can't just put a researcher in a car with someone and have them watch as the person is texting and driving and doing something else that's really dangerous. So sometimes what we have to do is recreate that setting in a lab. Maybe do like a driving simulator or something like that. The other issue is something called the Hawthorne effect. Now, the Hawthorne effect is a phenomenon that occurs when a person modifies their behavior because they know they're being watched. Basically, it's that people like to put their best foot forward. I'm not going to text and drive if someone's watching me because I know that that's something I shouldn't be doing. Where this is bad though, is that naturalistic observations aren't about seeing what people should do. They're about seeing what people actually do in the real world. The way we get around this Hawthorne effect is to limit as much as possible any type of interaction between the researcher and the subjects of the naturalistic observation. The ideal is to have the subjects not even know that they're being watched in the first place, but of course, this can be kind of difficult. The next type of study we're going to talk about are surveys. There are many different types of surveys, but what they have in common is that they present predetermined questions to a large group of people. This can be in the form of closed-ended or open-ended questions. A closed-ended question is one that can only be answered a certain way. So something like a multiple choice question or true-false. An open-ended question is one that allows a person to be more descriptive of how they answer. So basically like an essay type question. An example of a closed-ended question would be like me asking you, did you study this week? An open-ended question would be more like me saying, what is your study schedule? So surveys ask a series of the exact same questions to a large group of people. The results can then be analyzed and conclusions drawn. They can be really helpful because you can reach a really big group of people in a really short period of time. I mean, think about it for a second. I can do a survey about study habits and send it through email to every student at a university and probably get back a large number of responses. Surveys can also allow for anonymity. This kind of goes back to that Hawthorne effect that I mentioned earlier. People change their behavior if they know that they're being watched. If I can send an anonymous survey where the person doesn't have to say their name, then maybe it'll help with them being a little bit more honest with how they answer the survey. A great example of this comes from a survey done in the United States in the 1940s. It was called Sexual Behavior in the Human Male. Basically, what they did was asked a large group of men questions about their sex life. They found out some things that were pretty shocking to people at that time. For example, they found out that a large amount of men admitted to having sex with prostitutes, masturbating, and cheating. They also found out that a pretty sizable number of men admitted to having homosexual fantasies and engaging in homosexual behaviors. Remember, this was the 1940s. Many parts of the country actually had laws against homosexuality. Psychology at that time actually viewed homosexuality as being a mental health disorder. You can imagine that was pretty shocking to them at that time, and they probably wouldn't have found this out if the survey wasn't anonymous. There are some drawbacks, though, to surveys. First, you need to be careful with the word choices you use in order to avoid ambiguity. The wording of a survey needs to be really clear. Second, you need to make sure that the way you conduct the survey isn't leaving anybody out from your population that you're sending the survey to. The example I gave earlier about sending an email with a survey to college students means that students that may not have had access to a computer or to their email will be left out, or that students that just don't check their emails too often may be left out. The final type of descriptive study I'm going to mention is actually the easiest, and it's the one you're all probably the most familiar with. Archival research involves looking at available data, research, and studies. Think of it like when you do an essay for a class. You are given a topic and then have to conduct research based on that topic. In college, especially during the first 2 years, the topics given are usually ones that are either already known to be true or that are more like ethical debates or subjective in nature. In research, it's usually to see if there are gaps in our understanding of topics. So they typically help us give focus and direction for later research to be conducted. All of the studies I mentioned in this video play an important role in the way research is conducted in psychology. However, remember that they are also only meant to give a description of something, not to show if a relationship exists or if there is a cause and effect between two things. Thanks for watching, everybody.